What's poppin', y'all? Welcome back. In this video, we're continuing our conversation about the general linear systems problem where we're given a rectangular matrix A, a right-hand side vector B, and we're looking for complete solutions to the system. We're going to introduce a bunch of definitions and formal notation to describe some of the observations we've made in previous videos. Remember that our main strategy for solving general linear systems problems is to manipulate the original general linear systems by multiplying on the left-hand side by a sequence of elementary matrices. In other words, when we multiply on the left, we're manipulating rows of the original modeling matrix A. We do this manipulation until we get the entire system into special form UX equal Y, where the matrix U is in either REF or RREF. During this transformation, we use special features of the matrix A and the matrix U to guide our reduction strategy. In this video, we're going to give formal definitions to those features that we can refer back to as we get more advanced in our linear algebraic techniques. The first definition we're going to talk about is something called a pivot position of the matrix A. If we have a matrix A, which is an M by N, coming from a modeling context, so mathematicians call that given, and then we put A in RREF form, we say that the pivot positions of the matrix A are the positions used to eliminate all other terms in the same column while we're transforming A into the matrix U. In other words, these pivot positions in A correspond to the leading values of 1 in U through our transformation. Let's think back to our work on the final approach linear systems problem. In this case, we had a matrix A that was non-singular coming from constraints on a polynomial curve fitting problem. We had 1, 2, 3, 4 different pivots. And remember, in the first translation, we permuted rows 2, 3, and 4. Specifically, the second pivot position came from the third row in the original matrix. When I look at this matrix U, the simplified matrix, that number 1 actually corresponded to the position 3, 2 in my original matrix. Looking back to this definition, we would say that pivot position 1 was in entry 1, 1. Pivot position 2 was in entry 3, 2. Pivot position 3 was in entry 4, 3, and pivot position 4, that last pivot in my matrix U, actually happened in entry 2, 4. For more specific information about where these came from, look back on your notes in this transformation. The whole idea, though, is these positions were the ones that we used to zero out all other elements in the appropriate column. In addition to the idea of pivot positions, we also have something called pivot entries of our matrix. We say that a pivot entry, also known as a pivot element, or for short, we could just call that a pivot, of the matrix A is the coefficient found in the pivot positions of the matrix A. So in our final approach linear systems example, the first pivot in our matrix A has value 1, the second pivot has value 1, the third pivot has value 800, and the fourth pivot has value 64 million. Notice that the pivot values, pivot entries of the matrix A are not the same values of the pivots in the matrix U. We have to be a little careful. This definition comes in very, very handy as we mature in our approach to linear algebra. When we get into the concept of pivoting for numerical linear algebra, using calculators and computers to do the numerical simplifications quite quickly, this definition will play a huge role. There is a famous theorem that says when you're doing simplifications, we want to choose the largest magnitude elements in each row or column and use those as our pivot entries. That's called diagonal dominance. That concept is beyond the scope of an introductory class and gets into numerical round off in IEEE 754 format. But I want to say the reason we're introducing this definition in this introductory class is to set the stage for that larger conversation. Here's a quick recap. Pivot positions are the locations of the elements used to zero out other entries in those columns in the original matrix. Pivot entries, or simply pivots, are the values of the coefficients found in those pivot positions. The next concept that we're going to formally define is called a pivot column of a matrix. If we start with our given modeling matrix, a pivot column of our matrix A is any column that contains a pivot in A. Another way to say that is pivot columns of A correspond to the columns of U that contain single non-zero entries equal to 1. When I translate my matrix A into RREF form, the pivot columns correspond to the linearly independent columns of U that have only one non-zero entry. As we noticed previously, the locations of the pivot columns of A are identical to the locations of the pivot columns of U. And in fact, we can see that in our first toy example that we did. We started with AX equal B. When we simplified this into UX equal Y, we saw that the first pivot column was the first column of A, and the second pivot column was the third column of A. That was also true for the pivot columns of U. And in fact, what we said was, as we construct the RREF form, this process of reducing my matrix into reduced row echelon actually shows the linear dependence of each column moving backwards. One way to interpret the concept of a pivot column is when I'm looking at each column and then relating those columns back to previous columns, pivot columns identify the linearly independent columns of my matrix when I look backwards. So in this case, we see column 1 is linearly independent. Column 2 is dependent on column 1. There is no new information contained in column 2. That is a non-pivot column. When I look at column 3 is linearly independent from columns 1 and 2. There is new information contained in column 3. That is a pivot column. Columns 4 and 5, no new information. Those are linearly dependent on pivot column 1 and pivot column 2. Those are non-pivot columns. Since we translated the matrix A into the matrix U using left multiplication by elementary matrices, the linear dependence relationships in the columns are maintained. That is this observation. The pivot columns of A are identical to the pivot columns of U. Of course, if we're going to introduce a definition about pivot columns, we can also do the same thing for rows. We say that a pivot row of a matrix is any row in our matrix that contains a pivot element or a pivot. In this case, we see that the first pivot row is actually row 2 because that contains the first pivot. And the second pivot row is row 1 because that contains the second pivot. Remember, in this example, we actually switched rows 1 and 2 when we were doing the elimination. And that's because this lazy bum wanted to avoid using 3 so that I didn't have to deal with fractions. In other words, it doesn't have to be the case that pivots occur sequentially down the rows. All I'm looking for is where are the individual pivot elements in each matrix. Those are the location of the pivot rows. Another way to look at pivot rows are these are the rows of A that eventually get translated into these rows of U that contain my leading entries equal to 1. Notice that because I left multiply to turn A into U, and I was multiplying by elementary matrices, the row that includes the pivot in U is not necessarily identical to the row that contains the pivot in A. Specifically, because I'm allowed to permute the rows of A in order to create the rows of U, pivot rows are not maintained through this reduction. Here's a quick recap. We say that a pivot column is any column containing a pivot entry. When we're counting the number of pivot columns in our matrix, that's identical to the number of linearly independent columns in our matrix when we look backwards towards the first column. Because the reduction strategy from our original modeling matrix into RREF form happens from left matrix multiplication, the linear dependence relationships amongst the columns are maintained, and the location of the pivot columns in our original matrix A are identical to the location of the pivot columns in our reduced matrix U. Pivot rows, on the other hand, are the rows of our original matrix that contain the pivot entries. The pivot rows of our original matrix A are not identical to the pivot rows of the matrix U because we are using left multiplication and manipulating the rows of the matrix A algebraically to get that matrix in special form. The final remark that I'll make now to set us up for future conversations is, do you notice that the number of pivot rows always equals to the number of pivot columns? That's a theorem that is actually quite deep and we'll explore later in these videos. With the definition of a pivot column in hand, let's define the opposite idea. A pivot column is a column that contains a pivot. Could you guess what a non-pivot column is? Ding, 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 ding. You got it. A non-pivot column of a matrix is any column in that matrix that does not contain a pivot element. Another way to say this is these non-pivot columns correspond to the columns of our special form matrix U that do not contain the single non-zero entry. Looking back to our second toy example, we saw that columns 1, 3, and 6 were pivot columns because they contained the pivot elements in entry 1, 1, in entry 2, 3, and in entry 3, 6. That immediately implies that columns 2, 4, 5, and 7 are non-pivot columns. There are no pivot entries in those columns. Combining the concept of non-pivot columns with the concept of pivot columns, we can start to count the number of each type in each matrix that we encounter. We'll define the rank of a matrix to be the number of pivots in that matrix. Another way to say that is the number of pivot columns. Another way to say that is the number of pivot rows. We can again say that as the number of linearly independent columns in our matrix when we look from left to right. We will refer to this non-negative integer as R and define a function called the rank of our matrix, which literally counts how many pivots do I have in my original matrix. Notice when I go from my modeling matrix to the special form RREF of that modeling matrix, the number of pivots is maintained. Thus, the rank of the matrix A in this case is 1, 2, 3. That is identical to the rank of the matrix U, 1, 2, 3. Here we're using rank to count the number of pivot elements or the number of pivot columns in our matrix. We're also going to define the number of non-pivot columns in our matrix, and we're going to define that using the variable f. You've seen that in our examples previously. We say that the number of non-pivot columns is going to be the total number of columns minus the number of pivot columns. That makes sense. Each column is either a pivot column or a non-pivot column, so that partitions quite nicely the total number of columns of our matrix. When we look down to our second toy example, the total number of columns is 7. 3 of those columns are pivot columns. That immediately means 1, 2, 3, 4, aka 7 minus 3. The number of non-pivot columns must be 4. So F in this case is equal to 4. With this, we've defined a ton of formal terminology to start helping us talk about very, very specifically what's happening when we reduce our matrix A into the matrix U. The progression that I like to think about is start with the pivot positions, the location that we're going to use to zero out all other ones in the row. The entry or the value in those positions are going to be called the pivots. The columns in which those pivots sit are called the pivot columns. Similarly, the rows in which those sits are called the pivot rows. Any column of our matrix that does not contain a pivot is a non-pivot column. In math, we like to count stuff. The rank of a matrix counts the number of pivots, which is equal to the number of pivot columns, which is equal to the number of pivot rows, which is equal to the number of pivot positions. Literally, when I'm counting the rank, I'm counting how many pivots are in my matrix. I like to think about that as the number of linearly independent columns in the matrix A. We call that number lowercase r. The complement or the other portion of that is the lowercase f, and that counts the number of non-pivots. We always say that the number of non-pivots plus the number of pivots is equal to the total number of columns. In the next video, we'll take a look at how all of this plays out when we're looking at general linear systems problems and specifically referring to the solution sets or the complete solutions to those problems. I'll see you in the next video.